Throughout the NBA during the 1990s, there's a lot of notable names, key figures who set the foundation for that decade and stamped their name in the history books forever. Legends from guys like Michael Jordan, Hakeem Olajuwon, Malone and Stockton, Charles Barkley, and much, much more. However, one of these names have been long forgotten, yet he was a guy who brought so much excitement, so much joy to a league that was rapidly growing around the world. Yet now, he's only a footnote in NBA history. The man I'm talking about is Sean Kemp, the Rain Man. Along with Gary Payton and Detlef Schrempf, they were at the forefront of the Seattle Supersonics, one of the most dominant teams of that decade, and for many fans, they were arguably the most fun team to watch. Unfortunately, Sean Kemp's career came to a horrific end, and he flamed out very quickly after his days in Seattle were over. How's going, folks? My name's Andy, and today, let's talk about Sean Kemp's underrated NBA career along with his tragic downfall. But before I start, I'd like to give a shout out to my sponsor, Skillshare. Skillshare is an online learning community that offers a wide array of classes, self-discovery, and a sense of fulfillment. Learning is essential in times of hardship to get your mind focused on a goal that you want to achieve. It offers classes that include illustration, graphic design, web development, marketing, creative writing, and much, much more. Personally, I've always loved typography and digital illustration, so I'd recommend this class by Jeanette Liao. Skillshare is very affordable and helpful for your own future endeavors. For a limited time, the first 1,000 people to click my link in the description will get a free trial of Skillshare Premium. Thank you to Skillshare for sponsoring this video. With the 17th overall pick of the 1989 NBA Draft, the Seattle Supersonics chose Sean Kemp. Unlike most other prospects, Kemp did not go to any major college. Well, he did attend Kentucky, but due to his low academic scores, he was not allowed to play basketball there. However, his draft stock was mainly based on his high school accomplishments, where he was ranked as a top 5 player of his graduating class. He would subsequently be named to the Elkhart County, Indiana Hall of Fame. Anyway, in 1989, he would join a Sonics team that was in the beginning stages of rebuilding. For a while though, they were still treading in the middle with a couple of guys like Dale Ellis and Xavier McDaniel leading the way, but the team wasn't getting anywhere. After a complete overhaul of the roster and drafting Gary Payton in the 1990 draft, they were starting to rise. By Kemp's second season, he was already averaging over 15 points and 8 rebounds a game. With more minutes and more opportunities, he would move into the starting lineup as the coaching staff really liked his energy and intensity. On top of all this, there was a time when he drew legitimate comparisons to Michael Jordan, believe it or not, and that's crazy to think about now. But back then, it wasn't unusual. In a 1992 article for Sport magazine, Mike Kahn stated, "The natural strength, quickness, and jumping, plus the daunting expressions after a particularly impressive move, all bear a striking resemblance to Michael Jordan." Jordan himself admitted that he saw the resemblance and agreed that Kemp showed a remarkable talent and sense of creativity. From 1993 to 1998, Kemp would make 6 straight All-Star appearances, including 3 All-NBA selections. He would average over 18 points, 10 rebounds, a steal and a block, and became Gary Payton's right-hand man, his primary partner in the pick-and-roll. Arguably the second-best pick-and-roll finisher of that era, right behind Karl Malone. Together, Kemp and Payton led the Sonics to multiple deep playoff runs, including a finals appearance in 1996, where they ultimately lost to the Chicago Bulls in a tight 6-game series. On the court, Kemp captivated the audience and became incredibly popular in Seattle. While he did carry the reputation of being mainly a dunker and finisher, his game rounded out over the years. Eventually, he became a low post scoring threat, a dominant offensive rebounder. And combined with his insane energy, it made him such a unique player and personality. However, off the court, he ran into a lot of issues. issues that continued to stack up and drastically affected his demeanor and his game. The first major incident happened in 1994. After a brutal loss to the Nuggets in the first round of the playoffs, the trade whispers became louder and louder. Coincidentally, another disgruntled superstar, Scottie Pippen, was having similar issues with the Bulls. There were questions surrounding his commitment and whether or not the Bulls wanted Pippen to lead their team after Jordan's first retirement. So the trade rumors between the Bulls and Sonics were rampant during the summer and the trade almost happened. But the Sonics owner killed the deal at the last minute. This did not make Kemp feel any better though. He was seriously pissed off that he was on the trading block in the first place. Nobody informed him, and the tension between him and the team continued to get worse. This tension was made public when Kemp was asked about it. He was asked about how he felt being in trade rumors all the time. "Haven't I played hard? Haven't I played well? Haven't I been an all-star? Haven't I behaved off the court? Haven't I signed autographs? Haven't I made those critics choke who criticized the Sonics for drafting a 19-year-old kid who hadn't played college ball?" Trading is all part of the game, but for Kemp, he lost a lot of trust in the organization. Additionally, his off-court behavior started to regress even further. After the Sonics lost in the 1996 finals, the following season was an absolute disaster for him. Throughout the season, there were many reports about Kemp's lackadaisical effort in practice and also rumors of him showing up drunk or heavily drinking the night before an NBA game. The most notable incident happened in February of 1997. On the day before a hugely anticipated rematch against the Bulls, Kemp stayed up until 2 a.m. at the Keg Steakhouse and Bar in Seattle, drinking his heart out for hours. He was still drunk on the same day of the game against the Bulls, hours before the game started. The tension continued with the Sonics not being concrete on offering him a new contract, nor did they want to, as Kemp looked like he was on the downswing of his career. Ultimately, they were correct. In the 1997 offseason, Kemp signed a massive 7-year, $107 million contract with Cleveland. Almost immediately, the Cavaliers had regrets. Kemp came into training camp out of shape and he spent the entire year trying to work his way back into shape. His athleticism, his quickness were nowhere to be seen. And as a result, his efficiency plummeted. In his 3 seasons in Cleveland, he registered the lowest field goal percentage since his rookie season. By 1999, a story from Sports Illustrated stated that Kemp has fathered 7 kids with 6 different women. Also, he apparently ballooned to over 300 pounds, even though his playing weight back in Seattle was around 250. Former Cavs GM Wayne Embry stated that Kemp was indeed 315 pounds after the lockout ended. Obviously, nobody wanted to see him like this. When the coaching staff asked him what happened, Kemp simply replied with, "Coach, I didn't think we were coming back." With that being said, Kemp actually averaged a career high in that lockout-shortened season, despite his ridiculous weight. Unfortunately, that short success was short-lived. By 2000, Kemp was traded to Portland, where his health rapidly deteriorated. Not only did his alcohol problems continue, but his rampant cocaine addiction became another huge issue. It was so severe that he was forced into rehab. At this stage of his career, he was no longer the same player or person he once was. In Portland, Kemp was only playing about 15 minutes a game, coming off the bench and putting up the worst numbers of his career. By 2003, at the age of 33, Kemp spent his final season in Orlando. You've probably seen this photo before, but here it is. As terrible as it sounds, this is probably the most iconic image of his career. You could see so much damage from just one photo. A man who was once touted as the most gifted athlete of his generation has been reduced to this, an overweight alcoholic. Even through all of these issues, Kemp had a change of heart and did work his ass off, lost a lot of weight to try and make a comeback. Up until 2006, he was even invited to workouts from a couple of teams, one of which were the Denver Nuggets. Even though he really impressed George Karl and the rest of the coaching staff, the Nuggets and other teams were very hesitant with taking a chance on him. Kemp talked about his inability to secure a contract with any team. "I'm a player with history," he said. "Most teams, regardless of what the sport is, it scares them. It scares them simply because they don't want to wake up in the morning and read something, look and hear something in the news. And that is what the situation is now." Basically, what he's saying is that his reputation was severely damaged to the point where it probably won't ever recover. Despite his efforts, he was not able to make a comeback. Years and decades have gone by, and Kemp has been remembered more for his downfall rather than his peak. But maybe we should remember him for how good he was. At one point, the Sonics were a legit contender, and their fast-paced run-and-gun style of play was headlined by Sean Kemp. Maybe it did not end on the best note, and maybe he could have done more to stay in shape if he was motivated. Perhaps the off-court issues were too much to overcome. It was a tragic demise of one of the most athletic and entertaining players the league has ever seen. Anyway, that's all, folks. That sums up the tragic story and downfall of Sean Kemp. Let me know your thoughts in the comment section. Do you think he's underrated? Where would you rank him among the top power forwards of all time? Thank you everyone so much for watching. I hope y'all enjoy the video, and as always, I'll see you next time. Peace.